Good morning, everyone, and welcome to Silver Lake United Methodist Church. My name is Alex Rosso, and it is a joy to have you in worship with us today on the last Sunday in October. My hope is that today, as we look at the stories of our faith through the stained glass windows, that through those stories, you will hear God speak to you. You will hear God speak to you through the songs that we sing together, the prayers that we pray together, the scripture that we read together. And my hope is that you encounter God's presence where you are worshiping today. With that in mind, I want to worship and continue to worship by lifting up a couple of announcements. In that, this week we have a birthday in the congregation. It's Corey York's birthday on October 29th. So happy birthday to Corey! And if you have a birthday that you would like us to help celebrate with you, I'd encourage you to put it in the comments. Or if you have an anniversary that you'd like us to celebrate, I'd invite you to put it in the comments as well, so that we can celebrate that with you and to lift it up to God and share in that joy. This week at the church, we have a couple of things going on. On Tuesday, we will have 25 boxes of produce available to everyone at 4:30. And this week, we've started to see a change where the boxes not only include produce, but they include dairy, and they also include some sort of meat. So we encourage you to share that with your neighbors, share that with your friends, share that with your coworkers, share that with your family, so those boxes can bless everyone in the community who needs them. Also, this week on Tuesday, there will be a devotion on the church's Facebook page. And so I encourage you to listen to the devotion or read the devotion as you're able this week. And then also just a reminder that I am out of the office until November 14th. Hopefully at this time I'm recovering from a surgery and it's going well, but so I invite you to keep me in your prayers in this time as well. With all that in mind, I encourage you to join us in the gathering prayer together.
Join me in saying the gathering prayer together. O God, creator of the universe, holy and all-powerful, you have spoken to us and shown us what love looks like in Jesus. He revealed your love and mercy to us by serving others and accepting them as people made in your image and likeness. He pointed us towards a world in which each and every person could realize their identity as a precious child of yours. May this time of worship be a reflection of our thanksgiving, wonder, and praise over such blessings. We pray all of this in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's continue to worship by singing "Here I Am to Worship."
Thank you.
Join me in the gathering words. Wisdom cries out in the streets. We hear and struggle to understand. Come and listen to the words of life and love. We hear and proclaim our faith in the one who brings life. Let us worship the God of life and wisdom, whose words guide us through our life on the right paths. Join me in singing, Lord, I lift your name on high. Join me in the spirit of prayer by saying the unison prayer together. Loving and caring God, we come this morning seeking wisdom and guidance for our lives. Open us to your words of life and love and truth. May we proclaim with our tongues what we know in our hearts. In this time of worship, help us more fully understand what it means to be a disciple, a follower of the way of Jesus, a follower of the path of wisdom. May the words of our mouths and the meditation of our hearts be acceptable to you, our rock and our redeemer. Amen.
And thank you to Ty and Eli Webb for helping lead worship this morning. And I also wanted to extend that invitation to you, too. You are able to help lead worship as well. So if that is something that you are interested in, I invite you to put that in the comments on Facebook or to get a hold of us at the church office so you can help lead worship on Sundays, too. It is great to see so many people helping and leading us in worship. And so as we go, I failed to mention that I encourage you to have your Bible with you as we get ready for the scripture reading today from the Gospel of Mark, so you can follow along and read it as we are led in the scripture reading. With all that in mind, I ask you to please join me in the spirit of prayer. Oh, gracious God, we come today gathered all together, lifting your name on high, singing your praises, proclaiming your greatness. Some of us can feel your love radiating out towards us and out from us. Others can feel your presence wrapping and surrounding them and encouraging and supporting them. God, we come today gathered with many things on our hearts, many things on our minds, and many things that we might be thinking about, needing guidance about, needing your help discerning what the next step might be. We ask that in this moment of silence, that your presence speaks to all of our needs, all of the areas needing guidance, all of the areas needing discernment, all of the areas needing your love, all and hope in our lives. So in this moment of silence, we lift up all the concerns of our hearts and our minds to you now. God, we give you thanks for your love and grace. We give you thanks for your presence that is always around us and surrounding us. We give you thanks for creating us in your image and showing us the way. And as we continue to pray, may we realize that your presence is with us in the many places we are gathered. And may whatever we say, whatever we do, whatever we think, always bring you all the glory, honor, and praise. May we exalt you every day of the week and not just on Sunday. We pray that we live into this pattern just as Jesus lived into the pattern and just as he taught the disciples to live in this pattern of loving you, O God, and loving our neighbor. And we pray all of these things in the same way Jesus taught his disciples by praying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Let's continue to worship by singing verse 1 of the hymn, Lord, Be Glorified.
I invite you to open your Bible to Mark chapter 8, verses 27 through 29 as I read today's scripture. Jesus and his disciples headed out for the villages across Caesarea Philippi. As they walked, he said, Who do the people say I am? Some say John the Baptizer, they said. Others say Elijah. Still, others say one of the prophets. He then asked, And you, what are you saying about me? Who am I? Peter gave the answer, You are Christ, the Messiah. May God add a blessing to the hearing, reading and understanding of God's word. Join me in praising God by singing, Great is thy faithfulness. Thank you.
Amen. And will you please join me in prayer as we prepare our hearts and minds and ears to hear what God might have to say to us today. God, open our ears, open our hearts, and open our minds to your voice, to where it is calling us to go, things it might be calling us to do, and things it might be calling us to say. Help us to live out our faith boldly and courageously each minute, each hour of the day. In your holy name we pray, amen. And so this week, we are in our third week of continuing our series on looking at the stained glass windows around the church and what faith stories they portray in their images. And so we've learned that stained glass windows started around the 7th century, and they had a natural way of adding light into the places of worship where they were put, but also they held this high esteem and beauty as they portrayed our faith stories in ways that words could not portray our faith stories. And so as we look at the stained glass windows, I'm thinking of just the amount of time and effort and creativity that goes into each one of the glasses throughout our church. And I'm just amazed at all of this and how God played a part in the creative genius of those who have created these stained glass windows. And so the first week we looked at the stained glass window that had the rainbow and the Cairo symbol, symbolizing God's presence and Christ's presence that is always with us. And then last week we looked at the two stained glass windows with the dove in them, symbolizing the Holy Spirit and how the Holy Spirit is our advocate here on earth. And so this week we turn to the third window. And this window is located on the west side of the sanctuary, as all the other windows are that we've explored so far in this series. And this story, this faith story that it portrays is Jesus as the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. That's what this window symbolizes. And so today, as we go forward and look at the scripture, we will be looking at the saying, King of Kings and Lord of Lords, where it was at throughout the Bible, what it might mean, what it meant for the early Christians as they said, Jesus is the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, and what it might mean for you and I as we make this proclamation that Jesus is the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. And so part of me, immediately when I say that phrase, King of Kings and Lord of Lords, it goes to the beautiful hymn where that is called the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. People sing it a lot better than I just did, but as I listen to it, I hear this church choir singing it in rounds and going around and with the resounding sound of everyone singing together, King of Kings and Lord of Lords, glory, hallelujah. I just imagine that around and round and round, King of Kings and Lord of Lords, glory, hallelujah. It's this beautiful ringing in my ears. It's this beautiful declaration that God alone is the King of all kings and the Lord of all lords. I wonder if you hear that song, that hymn, I wonder what it triggers in your imagination. Do you think of Easter Sunday, where death is defeated, and God, Jesus, is the King of Kings and Lord of Lords? What do you think of when you hear that statement? And so let's look at where this statement is made, the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, throughout the Old and New Testament, where God is called the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, and where Jesus is called the King of Kings and Lords of Lords. So join me by turning your Bible, opening your Bible, and turning towards the front of your Bible. Turn to Deuteronomy chapter 10, verses 17 through 19. And this is what it says. For the Lord your God is God of gods and Lord of lords, the great God, mighty and awesome, who shows no partiality and accepts no bribes. He defends the cause of the fatherless and the widow and loves the foreigner residing among you, giving them food and clothing. And you are to love those who are foreigners, for you yourselves were foreigners in Egypt. For the Lord your God is God of gods and Lord of lords, King of kings and Lord of lords. And then we see in the book of Psalm 136, 1 through 3, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His love endures forever. Give thanks to the God of gods. His love endures forever. Give thanks to the Lord of lords. His love endures forever. Man, can we just say those words of that Psalms? It's this praise statement that we should say more often in our lives. So join me in saying this. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His love endures forever. Amen. Give thanks to the God of gods. His love endures forever. Give thanks to the Lord of lords. His love endures forever. Amen. And so when the early Christians heard that God was the King of kings and Lord of lords, they knew his love endures forever. And the mountaintop moments and the valley moments, God's love endures forever. And so then we move to the New Testament. And we read this in the book of 1 Timothy chapter 6, verses 11 through 16. And it's the Apostle Paul talking. But as you, for you, people of God, pursue righteousness, holy living, faithfulness, love, endurance, and gentleness. Compete in the good fight of faith. Grab hold of eternal life. You were called to it, and you made a good confession of it in the presence of many witnesses. I command you in the presence of God, who gives life to all things, and Christ Jesus, who made the good confession, testifying before Pontius Pilate, obey this order without fault or failure until the appearance of our Lord Jesus Christ. The timing of this appearance is revealed by God alone, who is the blessed and only Master, the King of kings and the Lord of lords. He alone has immortality and lives in light that no one can come near him. No human being has ever seen or is able to see him. Honor and eternal power belong to him. Amen. And so it lays out this groundwork as disciples of Jesus Christ, as disciples of the King of kings and Lord of lords, we are to pursue righteousness, holy living, faithfulness, love, endurance, and gentleness. We are to pursue those things because that's what the Lord of lords and the King of kings pursues. And then we read in the book of Revelation, chapter 17, verses 12 through 14. The 10 horns that you saw are 10 kings, and you haven't yet received royal power, but they will receive royal authority for 1 hour, along with the beast. These kings will be of one mind, and they will give their power and authority to the beast. They will make war on the Lamb, but the Lamb will emerge victorious, for he is the Lord of lords and King of kings. Those with him are chosen, called, and faithful. And so in this passage of scripture, as we learned in our study on the book of Revelation, is that the kings of earth, they have power and authority for 1 hour. Then the beast comes, and the beast has power and authority for 42 months. And then the power of the Lamb, Jesus Christ, is for 10,000 years. And what that signified for the early Christians was for eternity. They couldn't fathom what 10,000 years was. They couldn't conceptualize it. And so Jesus Christ, as the King of kings and Lord of lords, who will reign eternally. And so what did it mean beyond that for these early Christians, for Jesus' 12 disciples that were around him, to call Jesus the King of kings and Lord of lords? What did it mean when they called him that? And so I think as we go to and look at this, we must go to the Gospel of Mark. And so as we go to the Gospel of Mark, some of the background is that many of the people in the Roman Empire, where Jesus was in ministry in ancient Turkey, in modern day Turkey, in the ancient Near East, they thought Jesus was merely a prophet, merely a messenger of God. And so when Jesus identifies himself as the Messiah, it confuses them, especially when Jesus says, I am the Messiah, I am the King, but I'm going to suffer, die, be rejected, and rise again, it confuses the disciples. Because their understanding of who the king was coming and who the Messiah would have been is one that was coming with a sword and shield and was going to wipe away the Roman army. It was going to wipe away all those forces that were kept on invading them and rule over them, but yet keep their enemies away and decimate and defeat their enemies. They thought their Messiah would rule with king, with power and might. But you and I know, as we read the story of Jesus, he didn't rule with the power and might of armies. The power and might of Jesus was completely different than that. The identifying Jesus as the Messiah for the early disciples was confusing because it was different than what their society and what their culture thought. And so as we see this in the Bible, we see how hard it was for the disciples that they wrestle with Jesus being called the King of Kings and Lord of Lords when everything that's going to happen to him, because as we hear Jesus teaching about it multiple times throughout the scripture. Think of how difficult it's been for us in the United States to change society and change cultural perspectives on racial equality. Equality has yet to be realized after centuries of social justice work, showing this shows and illustrates and illuminates the difficulties Jesus must have faced while teaching the disciples of what type of Messiah he was going to be. With all that being said, reinterpreting the understanding of Jesus as Messiah was challenging, and it challenged the disciples' traditional understanding. And how did that affect the communities that they served, their Christian communities that they were a witness to? And so before this passage in the Gospel of Mark, we see Jesus teaching who he was, and then saying to a person, don't go tell anyone. And then after this teaching, we hear Jesus once again teaching about who he was. And these people get it. The blind person gets who Jesus was. The disciples don't. That's right in the middle. And then once again, we see another blind person seeing who Jesus was. But the disciples here in this passage of scripture still don't get it at first. And that gives me hope as a disciple of Jesus. Sometimes I won't get it. Sometimes you won't get it. Other peoples will get it. And we're supposed to come along beside each other and encourage each other and support each other and have that dialogue with one another. So we continue to grow in our relationship with God and grow in our relationship with others. And so this before Peter's confession in Mark 8:29 is really important. Jesus' identity, like I said, is yet to be known by the disciples. Jesus heals a blind man, the blind man of Bethsaida, in Mark 8:22 through 26, thinking of, and this reminds us of maybe the blurred vision that the disciples had of Jesus at the time. They had bits and pieces. They had been around him and understood some of his teachings, but they didn't have the full picture yet. And so the blind man himself has to be healed twice to see clearly. And many scholars believe this could point to the multiple teachings of Jesus to the disciples after Jesus' own identity as Messiah, as King of Kings and Lords of Lords is revealed. And so Peter, in the middle of this passage of scripture, clearly identifies that Jesus Christ is the Messiah. And then right after this, Jesus follows it up by telling them what it will take to be a disciple of Jesus Christ. But the important part is this confession of Peter that Jesus Christ is the Messiah. Jesus Christ is the Lord of Lords and King of Kings. And so each time after this, Jesus, he goes on to predict his own death, which was countercultural for the disciples at the time to understand their Messiah would suffer. And each time it is followed by teaching the disciples what it means to be a disciple of Jesus Christ. And then around these three things and corrections and teaching, Jesus heals another blind man. And so prior to Jesus' entrance into Jerusalem on Holy Week, the blind man instantly sees, which alludes to the faith that we must have as followers who are unable to see and hear Jesus' teachings firsthand, but yet we still have faith. We still have faith. And the irony of the Gospel of Mark should not be missed by everyone. It's this struggle to learn about who Jesus was by the disciples, but yet knowing that what Mark begins his gospel message with in verse 1, saying, "This is the good news about Jesus, the Messiah, the Son of God." But yes, throughout the Gospel of Mark, you see the disciples struggle with understanding who Jesus was. The irony is that after laying what the book of the Gospel of Mark is about in verse 1, Mark then spends the next three quarters of the gospel answering the question, who is Jesus? And so Peter's realization that Jesus is the King of Kings and Lord of Lords in Mark 8:29 is the turning point in the Gospel of Mark. Up until this point, Jesus' ministry had consisted of miracles. He had walked on water, fed thousands of people, healed blind people, and all in all, up until this time, there were not many hardships experienced by the disciples. And so here in Mark 8:29, the disciples become uneasy when Jesus is known as the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Instead of witnessing these miracles of Jesus and these miraculous healings, Jesus begins to teach them new things about the type of Messiah Jesus is, about how he will be and live and move in ministry. And he lists the conditions and things that they might experience as disciples. They too will be rejected. They too will be persecuted. They too will suffer. It's the first time hardship had been encountered by the disciples. And so this reminds me of times in my life when I've encountered hardships. And when my life, when things are going well, when I tend to rely less on God and I tend to rely more on myself, it is easy to neglect spiritual disciplines like reading my Bible, praying daily, seeking conversation with other people of faith. It is easy to just kind of push those to the side when things are going good. But even the disciples, we read in this passage of Mark, fall into this trap. Things are going good up until this point, and then all of a sudden they learn that they might suffer, be persecuted, and they too fall into this trap. They too were able to reorient their lives toward living out the gospel of love after multiple corrections and multiple teachings, just like you are, just like I am, when we fall into the trap of relying on ourselves and relying on our own understanding. It is this love that we have to draw upon when our lives get hard and our lives get uncomfortable. But then also, as we process this statement that Jesus Christ is the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, I think we as Americans lose kind of some of the context of what this statement might mean. And so as American Christians, we don't have a very good context of thinking about what a kingdom was, or even like Jesus as Lord. So the pictures of my head of King of Kings and Lord of Lords, they come more like I picture kings from like Disney shows and the Princess Bride and Robin Hood, Prince of Thieves. That's what I think of when I think of kings and lords. It's hard for me to think about how what this statement might have meant for the early disciples who were experiencing it, had kings that were ruling over them and lords that were ruling over them. Because these TV shows and movies, they inform my relationship with the title King and Lords in my daily life. I think the lack of our context makes us miss something important from today's scripture. And so when Paul talks about the King of Kings and Lord of Lords in the book of Timothy, Jesus' earlier followers would have had plenty of context for words like kingdom and Lord. In their world, they were people who were most often one person who told them what to do would have been the Lord. And the lords and kings would have commanded armies to make sure that what they had said happened. Independence in their days was not an option. They had daily constant reminders of their life, of the power of a Lord, and they often lived as subjects of a kingdom that told them what to do, when to do it, and who to live, take their life, and could also take their lives just on a whim. And so calling someone Lord had to do with living in darkness and oppression for them. And so the kings in their lives rarely brought light and didn't even think of them as important parts of their daily routine or life, other than that they were necessary functions of service to take to the land, to do tasks, to do work for them. And here is Paul talking in terms of Lord, of lords and King of Kings. And what Paul is talking about, he is talking about as being this person for Jesus' sake. And Paul goes on to paint this picture of what it takes like to be a servant of Jesus Christ, the King of Kings and Lords of Lords. And so Paul paints this picture of a king that doesn't have to do with crowns or fairy tales. It doesn't have anything to do with Disney shows, The Princess Bride, Robin Hood, Men of Thieves. He talks about this king that has to do with light shining out of the darkness. Paul says that light shining from Jesus himself is how we see God's glory, not some created kingdom that will come and go. He says that we are rooted and established and built upon Jesus and established in faith. We can live a life that is overflowing with thanksgiving. We can understand what Christ's kingdom and God's kingdom looks like when we are established and rooted in this overflowing thanksgiving for God and sharing our light. And so that helps to give context to how the early Christians would have understood King of Kings and Lord of Lords, because sometimes that can be lost on us without having a King of Kings and Lord of Lords context. And so what does it mean for us today to say that Jesus Christ is King of Kings and Lord of Lords? Maybe the better question is, what does it mean to say that Jesus is the King of your heart? And so I think of this for me and myself is that when I say Jesus Christ is Lord, it is this affirmation of faith. And that when we say Jesus Christ is Lord, we as a community, we join all the disciples, all the saints that have gone before us and proclaimed the same thing. It is just as powerful for the early Christians as it is for us today. While they were saying that Jesus Christ was King of Kings and Lord of Lords of our life and not Caesar Augustus, we are saying whatever is in the world that we are putting as idols in front of us, whether it is money, whether it is power, whether it is a political party, whether it is an ideology, that those are not the kings of our lives. Jesus Christ alone is the King of Kings and Lord of Lords of our lives. It is meant to say that Jesus Christ is the most powerful person in our lives. Because remember, the title of Lord itself for the early Christians was given to someone who had power, influence, and authority over a person's life. And so when we say Jesus Christ is King of Kings and Lord of Lords, we are saying that God alone, Jesus alone, is that person. Jesus alone is that person who has power, influence, and authority over our lives. And so remember, when the disciples are asked by Jesus in the Gospel of Mark, Jesus asks the disciples this question: who do people say I am? And the disciples respond, some say John the Baptist, others say Elijah, and still others, one of the prophets. But what about you? What about you? And I pause there in this part in the scripture because I think that's a question that Jesus is asking you and I today. If we pause there, what is our answer? But what about you, he asks. Who do you say I am? Who do you say I am? Peter answered, you are the Messiah. You are the King of Kings. You are the Lord of Lords. And so you and I, we as disciples of Jesus Christ, when we say this and sing this song, King of Kings and Lord of Lords, we join in this historical affirmation of faith along with the Apostle Peter and the Gospel of Mark. When we say Jesus Christ is Lord, it means that Jesus Christ alone has the power, authority, and influence over our lives, not the government, not politics, not society, or not culture, but Jesus Christ alone. Will you please join me in prayer? Lord Jesus, you are the King of Kings. Lord Jesus, you are the Lord of Lords. We cannot fully grasp all the reach of that and what that fully means, but we can and do ask you to be Lord of our lives, to make us be the people you want us to be. Amen. At this time, I invite you to continue to worship with us as we go to the offering in which we give God's our tithe, give God God's tithes in our offerings as a part of worship. And before we go to the closing hymn, the Spirit has moved me, and through the offering song that was played, will you please join me in prayer, and I'd encourage you to repeat these words after me. Oh God, we need you. Every hour, we need you. Jesus, you are the Lord of Lords and King of Kings. We ask you. We seek you. We invite you to be the King of our hearts. Amen. Will you please continue to worship with me by singing the closing hymn, Sent Forth by God's Blessings. Will you please hear the benediction? Go forward from wherever you are worshiping, knowing that the King of Kings and Lord of Lords is with you wherever you go. Amen.